Hello and welcome to yet another episode of TestSpeak Special Feature, and I'm your host, Brijesh Deep. Well, when you look for inspiration from people around you, there are oftentimes you meet people who just don't give you an impression if they are hi-fi people or they are extraordinary people. They just come and inspire you. My guest today is one such person who, in his very subtle way, in his very simple way, has inspired not just me, but many. He, in my opinion, is a pioneer of initiatives, a great person, a great tester, and most importantly, a wonderful human being. With great pleasure, I want to welcome my guest, Mahesh Chikne. Welcome, Mahesh.
Thank you, Brijesh, and thank you for the wonderful introduction. As I always say, you probably become more kind to me always, and that's something I appreciate.
Well, I will put away my glasses for today. I am able to see you though. For some reason, there's a lot of glare that's coming through my glasses, and I was not able to see you clearly. It's better that I put my glasses aside for the day. So this is how I look without glasses, guys. If you're watching me,
I need the glasses.
No, I mean the audience needs to know how I look without glasses, because probably in the interviews they've all seen me with glasses, and glasses have become important as you develop some gray hair. So that becomes an important part of life, and that's how I need them too. Well, you spoke about kindness. I think I'll be very candid in saying that you are one of the kindest persons I have met. Okay.
Thank you. So
the kindness that you're talking about actually is a reflection of the kindness that you offer to people. So that's how you get it. Mahesh, we know a little bit about Mahesh, but I was more interested in knowing about your journey as a tester, how you began and how things started in your life and how you reached where you are today. If you could share some highlights from your career so far.
Okay, sure. So I did my engineering from Pune University. Though it was a Pune University, the college wasn't really in Pune. So it is in Ahmednagar district in Maharashtra, and it's near Shirdi basically. And the college is very popular for it. It's in Pravaranagar, and the college is very popular for chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, but not that popular for IT computer and all. So when I got in for the first year, I realized, okay, there is nothing like placement and all which I can expect. And we were fine with it. Like, we were just enjoying the way college time goes, right? We were fine with it, and we were enjoying the time. So 4 years there were all fantastic. We all know how college memories are. And that's how it was. We graduated and none of us really had expectation, nor we were really bothered about there is no placement and all, because probably we didn't know how things go in the metro cities. Like, from third year only, from second semester the companies start coming, and by that time only you know which company you are joining. And because we didn't know that, I think it was a good part, because we didn't feel any pressure at all. It was all good for us. Post that, a few of my friends had discovered that in Hyderabad, in Amirpet, you can do a lot of courses from good teachers very cheaply. Like, it is like, if I remember it correctly, in 5,000 or 3,000 you can do core Java, advanced Java, and with that you will get something free. In 1,000 I think I did a course on shell scripting. Then the Oracle course fees were around 3,000 or something, and the person teaching was a Oracle Black Book author, and he was a Oracle consultant as well, a part-time consultant as well. The person who was teaching core Java, he was, if I remember it right, he was employed in some Indian Institute of Science or somewhere, where he was by during those time, like 90s or something, he was being paid 80,000. And then he was telling the story, like, I don't know the truth, but he was telling the story. And because teaching was his passion, he left that and, you know, he started teaching people in Hyderabad. So it's like a wedding hall or something, but like a big theater where you have fiber chairs and there are 100, 200 people sitting. And you are just one of them. And the person is like, you know, loudspeaker and all, he's teaching that. So it was a wonderful experience. That's why I added a few more things into that. So I did, I think, 6 to 7 courses there. I was there for 2-3 months. Initial week I was, you know, staying with my friends, and then I realized it is not very easy to, you know, adjust to a food you are not used to, right? So
yeah,
similar to probably everyone visiting Hyderabad for the first time and experimenting with the biryani, and if you don't do it at the right hotel, you probably will, you know, never dare to do that. So those things happened, and then I thought, okay, I probably, if I have a better option. So my uncle, he's in RBI and he was in Hyderabad there, so he had, you know, those like big quarter, like 2-2.5 BHK, and then I joined him there, and I was there for 2-3 months. So it was a good experience there. During that journey, then I got the test of, you know, how IT industry works and what really is competition, because there then we used to go for interviews, and, you know, I faced interviews wherein things like negative marking was there, and I could see like 1,000 people applying and a lot of things. During one of those attempts, I had cleared the Polaris round, but it was like a 3 years bond, and the pay was, you know, too less for the kind of responsibilities I was going to have. So with that, then I thought, you know, okay, let's not do that. I came back to Mumbai, and then again here one. So the Polaris one was development offer. The one I got again in Mumbai, again that was a development role, and the similar situation. The pay they offered was too less, and then I thought, oh, probably I cannot go ahead with this, because then you are expecting a commitment as well for a few years. So it was like when I went back to my hometown, which is Shirur, like near Ahmednagar and Pune, that's when I got an email from Zykus that there is off campus. And when we applied that, quite a few friends of mine applied. And when we went there, there were 3,000 people. Okay, 2,000 to 3,000 people. It was a campus near Baner, and like all 2-3 buildings, they were all packed, and like multiple batches, like first round of apti done, second round of apti done, and like that. So with that, we went with that, and, you know, there was a question around test cases as well, apart from the coding questions, and probably they noticed something in that. And like fast forward, I won't talk about the rounds, that itself has a lot of story. They noticed something, and then I got a call that you are selected for a testing role. And then I thought, okay, let's see how it goes. And our then VP, he was taking a final round, and that's where I asked, if I don't find testing interesting, will you be able to, you know, move me to the development role? The usual question we have.
Yeah.
And he said one wonderful thing back then, which like I still remember, and a lot of people should remember, do not fool your interest. So if your interest is development, do not fool that. And then I told, no, it's not like that. I am curious towards knowing what testing is, and I can possibly, you know, very well give it a try. And that's how the journey started back in 2010. And I'm still working with Zykus. So when I started, the product I joined, that was just 1 month old, and it is the most ambitious product of Zykus and the biggest one. And so the journey I started, there was just one more tester, a senior person to me. After a few months, he also left for the MS, and I was the only tester, and there were 16 to 18 developers. So that's how it started. It was very, you know, fun experience, I would say. because the team was so kind that I wasn't really feeling the pressure, but rather I was getting opportunities to let them feel the pressure. Like it was like routine, you know, because there were so many developers. I used to get one user story to test for, let's say, a few hours. I used to log whatever 40, 50 bugs I can find, then move to the next and then move on. So it was a very good routine, and from then the team went on increasing. So I saw the entire scratch to live phase from 1 person team to, you know, growing it to 40, 50 testers team, not in the same product, but as the years went on, I went on taking more products responsibility on the testing front. So that's how the journey has been. So far I have probably laid 7 to 8 products there in on different timelines on the testing front. Apart from that, I worked on quite a few automation frameworks. So because I was in leadership role, it wasn't like I was hands-on doing everything, but I was guiding the team what to do with, you know, what all things to add and how to do it and all. So we experimented with Selenium with Java. We sustained that. I use the word sustain because when we say automation, quite often it happens that we build something, the person who automated, you know, leaves the company. The next person who joins never finds that automation good. The way it is, like, you always find someone else's code, a crap, and then you end up scrapping it. But in this case, we were, you know, able to sustain it for good 5-6 years. Post that, we experimented with a so-called scriptless frameworks category. We experimented with OpKey, a tool called framework called OpKey. Then we did, we used Catalan Studio for good 1.5 years probably, before they started charging. And by the time we realized, probably the complexities we have are way too much. And then we need custom solutions for that. And currently what we are using is BDD with a wrapper called CodeCept.js. Along with that, we're using TypeScript and all for writing the logic. So currently I'm leading the automation COE, plus there are 2 to 3 products which I'm leading at Zycus. So that's how the journey has been so far.
Awesome. I mean, it's a great story. You spoke about your college and the Amir Pet story. Well, Amir Pet is definitely the place you want to be if you really want to learn stuff at the least cost. I mean, I know that it still has value. There is a lot of things still happening there. A lot of action happens daily. So I think that's good.
Sorry to interrupt. You know what is the best feature of Amir Pet, which I always remember? When in the evening time, during 5 to 6 p.m., if you walk on the street, you do not see the street. Okay? What you instead see are the pamphlets and brochures of all these classes. They used to do that heavy marketing, and people, you just take it and you throw it, right? And on the street, it is everywhere. Like, all the colors and all. So that's how crazy the marketing is.
Yeah, I can imagine, because I have not had the opportunity of visiting Hyderabad yet, but I've heard a lot of stories, and especially about Amir Pet. Of course, biryani is of course another thing. We'll talk about biryani. But one of the things that actually caught my attention is the fact that you've been with Zycus all along, okay, so 10 years. In today's fast-moving, chaotic world where, you know, people are looking for things that are different, I mean, they're looking for variety, they're looking for, something or the other which makes people or professionals switch their careers pretty quickly, okay? How does it inspire you or motivate you to stick along to the same company? What has been the motivation behind that?
Yeah. So I won't lie here. Like I won't say that that phase of, you know, boredom or phase of questioning never came. It very well came, you know, almost 2 to 4 times in this entire career of 10 years, almost 10 years. But it was like, as soon as, you know, I used to get into that phase, something else was ready for me, like, you know, a new product, or when initially it was just, you know, testing of all sorts we are doing. So that's anyway something which, you know, separates us from 80% of the world, because in a lot of companies, they still have different teams for different types of testing. And in Zycus, we never had that culture. The same team for that product does everything you can imagine. Even, you know, security testing to a certain degree, but though that is very less, because it is very deep thing. And we used to do it to a certain degree, like usual XSS, SQL injection, like, you know, anything around URL tampering and all. So those basic things we used to do. Then things around usability. So it wasn't like a tester cannot, you know, suggest on that. So for a lot of time, whenever there used to be new design, I was involved in, you know, giving the feedback for those designs as well. So what used to happen is, whenever I used to get into this phase, either automation will come, or some new framework will come, or, you know, I'm taking a responsibility of a new product or something. And that's how things, you know, stayed interesting for me all along. And whenever that phase used to stay for, you know, good 2 to 3 months, I won't say it like used to vanish quickly. And the culture is open enough that if I ask, you know, probably I need more things, or I need something else to work upon, then like serious thought used to be given to those things. And, you know, then you'll get something. Plus, what was the point is, like, I was very clear, after working in Zycus for some time, I was very clear I will not join a service-based company for my own reasons. I'll work in product-based companies, and, you know, that can be startup, mid-size or big, but, like, it should be a product-based company. And what was going well is, I was very confident, based on whatever discussion I used to have from people who are coming outside and joining my team, plus people who are leaving the team, though there were very few. So that's something I would want to boast about. The team I was able to build, you know, like for good 4 to 5 years, only 2 to 3 people left. And 2 out of those, you know, left for doing their higher studies and all. So that was the family we were like able to build. And I'm not sure if you spoke about this before, but like, this thing of community building was there during the Zycus days as well. Like, I'm still in Zycus, but I'm saying during the early days, I just didn't know it is called community and all. So we actually built a community, a micro community called Zycal Squad, of my, you know, entire group of 40-50 people. So we'll probably touch it later in the conversation. But to answer your question, that's how, you know, things worked for me. And I'm not someone who would be completely dependent on, you know, that, okay, my boss is not giving me something interesting to work upon, and hence I'll be demotivated, or my company is not giving me the opportunity, and hence I'll be demotivated. If in office I don't find something interesting, I'll try experimenting with something else. So I experimented a lot with shell script and all. I just love the power it has. So I'm not a pro at it, and I didn't practice it a lot for last few years. But I just loved it, like using Linux and, you know, working on shell script. That's a power of different sort. So those variations kept me, you know, glued there, and didn't really took me off the track.
Well, awesome. So, you know, as far as building teams and experiencing that joy, where, you know, you have a team where the team stays together for a long time, and with only a couple of people maybe moving in and out of the team. I have experienced that in my career. You know, for 5 long years, I managed a team where, you know, there were only a few people who just moved out, but the core team remained there, and we were able to build it strong enough so that the customer was very happy. That was a great experience. So I can absolutely relate to what you said. But my key takeaway is, you know, for any tester, or, I mean, since we're talking about testing, for any tester is to look within, try and discover what you actually are good at, and maybe try and do some experiments. Go out there and ask questions to people that you know you like to do this experiment, and if it is in line with something that you're working on, I don't think people will stop. And it is for organizations as well, based on what you said. A lot of us in senior roles should probably inculcate these habits in our organizations, that when we want to create a culture, you create a culture of trust. Okay, you create a culture of empowerment. You let people do experiments. You let people build communities. Because when we talk about communities, it is it has a direct impact on your work, because you get to learn so much within those communities, and work is the only place where you will come and try all the learnings, basically, right? If you really want to get something out of it, you won't want to show it that, hey, look, this is the cool stuff that I have learned, and this is how it works, and this is the direct benefit you get out of it. So I think that all of these points are good. So it is for both professionals and for companies to probably listen to your answer and do some takeaways. So thank you, Mahesh, for that. And since we spoke about communities, I cannot stop myself from asking you about it. And you are leading a community. I, along with three friends of mine, we've started a community. So community is what we thrive upon. So you started your community building journey in Zycus. Then what happened? And how did things happen towards community building? How did you build a document, and how did you take it further? What was your journey?
Yeah. So there are pros and cons of everything, right? So because we were doing, and we are still doing, so many things within the Zycus. So I talked about different types of testing, but it used to go beyond that, managing the entire infra, debugging the issues, deploying the builds yourself. So in the early time, we ourselves deployed the final release build on our demo and production setups when the product was going early. And that time we were experimenting, with a lot of things. Then eventually, when things settled down, I tried automating and did that, for the entire build deployment, which was going on multiple servers and all. So did that through shell scripting. Then next stage was, then stitching it with the Jenkins job. The next stage was we were using Slack. We still use Slack a lot. So, attach that entire deployment to a Slack command. So things like that, those, we used to keep on doing. Sometimes I used to create that inspiration for people. Sometimes other people used to come up with the ideas. And because there were so many things happening, and we were still, so as part of Zycall Squad, we used to meet the entire team of 40, 50 people. Majority of that team was sitting in Mumbai, but there were people in Bangalore and Pune as well. So we used to meet together every Wednesday for a couple of hours, and people can probably find a lot of stories about how we did the things there on my blog, maheshchikne.com. And we used to discuss anything, like that can be a trend, that can be a life story of something, that can be a book summary by someone. We used to play games. We played Mafia a lot. So if you all don't know Mafia game, you should give it a try. We played Mafia a lot. We used to just go out and have tea. We used to go out and have evening snacks. In Sib's area, there is a lake, and there is a beautiful garden around that. We used to just go there, stay, and discuss, ask candid questions to each other. So it was that close a family, and we were very open to each other. So everyone knew what is other person's interest, and so on. Each person even had a role, so someone who loves tea, we used to call that person TEO. So the way you call CEO, right? So TEO. So that person's responsibility is to take team on tea, every other Wednesday or something, whatever is possible. someone who is a food lover, so there used to be some title for that person. That person's responsibility is to make sure, if not very often, at least like once in a month or twice in twice every couple of months, we go on a lunch or evening snacks together and we eat together, and more things like that. So there used to be titles like trend tracker, someone who is very interested in latest trends. So your responsibility is to go grab the trend and present it to team and things like that. Now, once you do these things for a few years, then even though you know you are already doing a lot and you know you're falling into a better, like probably the top 10, top 20% of the industry, you still feel, okay, what more and what else? Right, and that's where I, along with few more members in my team, we realized, okay, we probably need to get better and we need to do more things and all. We tried that within our team as well, and there was a decent response. But we thought, okay, do we always want to restrict ourselves to a fixed set of people? And why not try experimenting something probably outside Zycus? And before that, I subscribe to the meetup groups which are there, the testing meetup groups which are there in Mumbai for good 2-3 years. And I was hoping, okay, someday there will be a meetup, like there will be a testing event, and I'll go and attend that, because that was very easy, like subscribe and wait for it, right? You don't have to do anything. That never happened. And I, back then, I wasn't aware of ATA. Eventually, I came to know, I attended one meetup, I think around maybe 2017 of the ATN. That's when I really got to know, okay, there is someone, who is already doing this stuff. And once all these discussions were going on, we thought, okay, let's experiment, with that and see how the Mumbai City testers respond to that. We did our first meetup, and as I was a new person, I don't know, how many people experienced that starting the events. We made the first meetup live. It was like social meetup. Come, have chat, drink coffee, have cute bites and couple of sessions and go. 45 registrations. I was like very happy, right? First meetup, you don't do anything. 45 people registered interest for that. What else you want? On a meetup day, apart from my team, who was like 5 to 7 people, only 2 more people turned up. And that's when I realized, oh, there are things like drop rate and all in event industry, which you need to be aware of. So initially, we were all, tense, and my entire team was, they were all calling up people now, whether you're attending or not. And you don't know that, okay, you need to send reminder to people, you need to put a meeting invite to that. Like all those things, we didn't know. And we learned it, but then we thought, okay, 7 to 9 people, sorted, we'll have good time and we'll leave. And that was such interesting meetup, and we were so happy at the end. We thought, okay, we are up to something good. And then I contacted Paras, whom I had met at a testing hackathon only in Mumbai, when he did one for Venture City. And then I thought, okay, I'm thinking maybe we can do a hackathon together, testing hackathon together. And he said, why not? And then we pulled one big the Bugfest hackathon in Mumbai, and it was like 108 people attended out of 120 who registered. And it was a big thing, like something which people hadn't seen, something which we hadn't seen, that a testing event so vibrant and people are loving it, irrespective of whether they are winning or not. And that was a real boost, right? So with that, I think people noticed, and a lot of people from other cities also, they reached out and said, okay, we would also want to do something like this in our city, and maybe we can drive those things. More and more people joined through initial Mumbai events. Like we Josley attended quite a few of those, then he became a regular attendee. In Bangalore meetup, Ajay started attending, then eventually Sandeep started attending, and more people, then they started contributing as well. They started driving those city chapters. And then it just went on from there. Like Pune started, then Delhi NCR started. Hyderabad, Chennai, we started very late, like just around last year, but that is going very well now. So fast forward to today, then we thought, okay, we need an online platform as well where people can collaborate, and that's where the online platform comes in. There are good number of events in the online category as well, that like webinar is there, AMA is there, and in the Buckfist itself, the Mumbai Hackathon, then Neeraj was one of the participants, and he also was one of the winning member, and Zycus was a hiring partner in that hackathon. So that's when I interviewed and met Neeraj. Then he joined the journey. We worked on a lot of good things, cool things together. Testaways, something we both worked a lot together, right? Both the testaways. So that was most fun experience, and that's something we are very proud of, that nothing of that sort has happened in the testing community in the world. Like a residence learning program for selected people, which you screen very cautiously, and which in a way turns out to be a life-changing experience for many. So a lot of testaway members from both Goa and Shimla chapter, they are doing fantastic. Someone just realized they are in the wrong company. They switched. He switched the company and doing fabulous job in moved to Australia and all. Someone started public speaking journey. Someone started blogging. Someone started with the freelancing thing. Someone started contributing to the community. So all sort of heroes emerged from both the testaways, and that's something we are really proud of, that we could experiment with that and do that thing. Because it's like taking 15 people from different parts of India to a common place for 3-4 days. That's something which was very adventurous, a daring thing, that what can possibly go wrong? What if you end up selecting a wrong person who is not fit for the team? And that's where reviewing people for their personal traits, their skill set, that they can add value, that they can be a team player, a lot of things were involved. And since then, like one experiment at a time, we just went on weaving it. And I think fast forward to today, you already know, like we did some 110 plus events in meetups, hackathons, webinars, AMAs, the tool related demos, workshops, testaway, TribalConf was a recent great success, thanks to people like you who decided to speak at TribalConf and make it great, because it's the content which makes it great, right? And raise the management part, that is still something we can manage with few people, but I think content is what made TribalConf a great testing conference. We are doing Test Freaks in November, which is like we are aiming to make it possibly the biggest testing event, because we are talking about 100 speakers from 40 different countries. That's a lot. If we think that okay, there are so many countries and 40 is a small number, it is not, because we are again talking about only countries where the IT presence is very strong, and they are involved in the community things, and we know about that. So we already reached, I think, 35 or something. So we are doing good there. So the idea is to connect as many testers as possible from across the globe on one single stage. So that's how the journey of the Test Drive has been. So it's good 2.5 years now.
How did you come to this name? I am very curious of the community.
So that credit goes to Kunal Asher. So he was part of initial 5-6 people who were in my team, and they aligned very well with my passion and my thoughts. Others as well aligned, but these were like okay, very passionate folks. Okay, if they align with my goal, they'll do things for that. And we were thinking, okay, we want to do a meetup. Then for doing a meetup, you need a name, right? So you need a name, you need a logo, and all that. And that's where we were experimenting with names, what we can do, and several online name generators and thoughts. We were like 5-6 people, and in that Kunal said, I think something around Testing Tribe. I said, okay, Testing Tribe look cool, because tribe is something which is like that sense of belonging is there. It's like a set of people who are stitched together very well. So it clicked, like tribe clicked.
With one focus.
Yeah. Yes. And then I said, okay, Test Tribe. Then Test Tribe came. I said, no, Test Tribe again looks kind of plain. let's make it the test drive. It's also, you know, making it triple T and adding some weight. Plus, at the same time, I visualized the logo, possible logo, which we couldn't design, right? But possible logo that, okay, there are three tribals who are like walking. If you see in the history books which we had, and they used to show those Warli paintings and all, that person will carry some weapon like a stick and will put hands like this. And that forms like a T, if you view it from that angle. So I thought, okay, there are three people we can show. Those are like tribals, and with that weapon, it's making a T. But that was too difficult a logo to design. We could never do that. But that's how the name came. Well, name and logo, both the credit goes to Kunal. The logo as well he designed, and I was just giving the ideas.
Well, you've named some wonderful people, starting from Paris to Jorsley to Neeraj to Ajay.
Sorry to interrupt, but before I forget, you know, I should give credit to more people who were there initially. Steffi was there, you know, whenever possible, she still contributes to TTT. Then Shubham was there, Amar was there, Priyabrata was there, right? I'm not sure if I'm forgetting more names, but yeah, these names made a lot of contribution to TTT.
Well, yeah, so I saw a few names I repeated, and then you added on to all of these names. I'm not sure if these people have heard about me, but I have heard about them. Okay, and there are a lot of other people who have heard about them, and we've heard all very nice things and how you work, and we've seen an example in Tribal Conf. I'll tell you something very interesting here. Okay, so 2020 was, you know, a year that began on a rough note with the corona thing. You know, it started off okay. I was in India at the end of 2019 and came back to the Netherlands and started, and work started. Life was getting to normal after a big vacation. And then in March, there is this corona thing and lockdown happens. And I'm like, this year is not going anywhere. I mean, what are we going to do? And then come April and May, I think it was in April, and a message drops in my Facebook messenger. And it's from a person called Mahesh Chikne. And he talks about participating in Tribal Con. And I'm like, okay, this is up to something. And then there is a long pause because I'm not able to get back to that person. And there is this, trying to catch up each other pace that goes on. And somehow we sync timings and we get to talk. And, I quickly do an introduction video and I send it across. That was just in time that I did, right at that moment where, things were going to close. So I did that and then prepared and then presented in Tribal Con. And trust me, when I saw the lineup of Tribal Con, the speaker lineup of Tribal Con, I had probably the biggest phase of imposter syndrome one could possibly have. Because I had so much self-doubt in me at that moment. I'm like, oh boy, this conference has James Buck, this conference has Michael Hood, this conference has Pradeep Sondarrajan, this conference has Santosh Bhakut, this conference has Ajay Balamurugan, this conference, I mean, who is not there in this conference is something that I started wondering. And I said, what will I speak in front of these people? I have spoken in conferences, but speaking in front alongside these people and making sure that my content is as good as your guests and resonating with the audience, I do not know what I'm going to do. And then I have so much of self-doubt, but then I said, okay, let me just go ahead and see what happens. And then on the conference day, things started. I started following, and my talk was on the second day, because on the first day I had another conference that was going in parallel.
Yeah.
And I was there, and that was the DopaConf for ATA. And I spoke on DevOps. And here I come, and then I presented what I presented in those 30 minutes. But the response that I got, you know, it really gave me a boost. It's like, okay, I've done something really good. Okay, and
you did.
And response not just from the people, but from other speakers. You know, they started messaging me and I started getting LinkedIn requests and Twitter follows and all that. And I'm like, oh my God, something has happened. Okay, and that was the change. So that was the second conference. And so far I've done 4 conferences, one AMA, there is one more talk possibly towards the end of the year. So good things have happened as far as public speaking goes. And, you know, with starting with ADA and then following your journey with the test drive, you know, I got a lot of confidence in you know, getting together with my friends and with Adibayo, Faiz and Sachin, and getting started with the test chat group. Okay, and test chat, I always had it in mind back in 2016. I want to share the story. Since we are talking back in 2016, I had first made a sort of a blueprint of a community that I was thinking of. Okay, it was a mind map. I had rough ideas there and all that. And I did not, neither had the resources nor had the courage to do so. Let me be very frank, because 2016 is when I had come to the Netherlands and I was looking for a job to be very successful. Okay, I had left my job in India. I came here and I was looking for a job, and so I was thinking about it. But you know, again, second half of 2016 is when the TTC idea originated. Again, it took rebirth, and I said, okay, now I have the courage. Now I have 3 more people whom I can talk to who resonate with my views, and we should probably try something. And we started, and hopefully we are you know, making some difference. We are still learning, you know, early days for us. It has just been 3 months, but we are, you know, 1,200 plus people in the group. You know, we've started doing these things, these interviews, people listen to, and we get some good feedback. We've got some suggestions also. So we are going to be doing some experiments. So, you know, all of this is a great learning. And like you said, I mean, you know, if you do things, and you have a good set of people along with you, you do more, you get a little more experimental, and then you learn from there. And, so it's been good so far. And Mahesh, thank you so much for being an inspiration, you know, to me and to the entire TTC group. So I really want to thank you. I want to thank, you know, Aditya Garg, whom I interviewed a few weeks ago for ATA, for making me a part of ATA and you know, letting me learn there. And then when I took the plunge here, I said, okay, I have 2 people whom I can look up to as far as communities go, and I am pretty sure that I'll get help anytime I want. So with that confidence, I've gone ahead. Now I want to take you back to the very first response that you gave, and I want to talk about something that you mentioned in that response. So you mentioned about, you know, tell script. Now this brings me to a very good point. Okay, when we talk of automation, we hear a lot about tools, right? We hear about, if in the modern day we talk about automation, if you talk to people, they will start talking about, oh, what tools should I learn? How is Selenium and how is something else? Now, when you talk about shell scripting, that is also automation, right?
Yeah.
So what message do you want to give to youngsters, to testers in general, as tools or you know, techniques are concerned, as far as their learning in automation goes?
So, for me, it was, you know, very clear that chasing the buzzwords is a risky part. Right, because by the time you manage to chase that buzzword down, the buzzwords have changed.
Yes. Right?
By the time people caught with Selenium Java, now people are already talking about Python. People are talking about Cypress. People are talking about PDD. Right. and we are already seeing a rise of JS based frameworks. A lot of dev frameworks are already going towards JS, right? The testing, the automation frameworks may also go there. We don't know. So the problem with chasing the buzzwords is that, and that's where for me it was like, okay, what different things I can do, and that's where these experimentations used to come. And because I did a small course on shell script in when I was in Hyderabad, but that was like I couldn't complete that. I came back to Mumbai. I had figured out that it is very powerful. The something which you can do in, let's say, five or 7 or 10 lines of Java code, you can do in like, you know, one line of shell scripting. It is that powerful. It is that fast as well. And then during those deployment days and debugging days, I learned it further. And it was more like, okay, it's not about what problem you are trying to solve. It's not about what you automate. If there is a problem, so there was a deployment related problem, and okay, rather than people running these 20, 30 steps differently, why not give them a single shell script which does the job? So I went for that. Then it was like, okay, they need to log into server, then there are two servers, and you know, they need to run that shell script twice. So can we do something else? So then, you know, attaching that to the Jenkins job. Then once that is done, we are using Slack, so other people are not getting more notified when the build deployment happens and all. So then stitching Slack with Jenkins notifications, and then it used to tell back in the channel directly that, okay, the build has been deployed and these are the new commits, right? Like, so things like that. So it's more about what problem you are trying to solve. So same went to when we experimented with API automation. So same way goes to the early days of, you know, when I was playing around with Postman, like what different things you can do with that. So automation is beyond UI automation. That's what I think. And it's more like, is there a problem? First of all, is there a problem which you are trying to solve? Once you notify, once you, you know, focus and freeze the problem, then you should think upon what tools are best suited for this. Like once that's we true. Noticed a problem around API automation, once we noticed that, okay, we need to do that. We were not doing it so far. We need to do that. And that's when we thought about tools. Like, it's not that, okay, Postman is cool, let's freeze the Postman first and then do the API automation. Then we thought about tools and compared that, how Postman will help. Few people did API automation using JMeter as well, whether that is the best suit or not, best fit or not. Then it goes to HTTP client and REST assured and, you know, what else? There is a tool, right, which was popular for API for quite some time. It's from SauceLab. I am not remembering.
Yeah, even it skips my mind. Well, anyway, yeah, so, there is
it was very popular thing, and then you know, I thought, no, this is something that the kind of configuration and language demand it has, that's not suiting. And then we went a totally custom way, writing our own API automation framework based on top of HTTP client. So things like that, like you first figure out. So it wasn't like, okay, I just need to experiment with scriptless tools, and that's when we went for Opki and Catalog. You know how, even though now it is a norm, like a couple of years back or 3-4 years back, when you talk about upskilling your entire team and making them, if not pro, at least decent in automation, it wasn't looking that easy. And that's where there was a problem that, okay, we need to scale on automation, but we cannot really, you know, our existing team is needed because they are already doing so many types of testing, they're adding so much value. Can we upskill them all to Selenium and Java? Looks tough. Then what else we do? We cannot hire so many automation engineers specifically. So that's where we thought, okay, this is something which looks promising, scriptless, that you don't have to code and all. The demos always look fine, and in demos it all look well. And that's when we went for those tools. We figured out the problems. We changed the tools. We customized that. Like, we customized Catalan so much that towards end, we were hardly using any core functionality of Catalan Studio. So it went till that degree. So that's how I believe, you know, the approach can be. Again, it depends context to context, but that's what I think. First, figure out a problem, then think about what tool, whether you really need automation there or not, and so on.
Yeah, fantastic response. I think a lot of testers who are either doing automation or are planning to learn automation need to listen to this. Now, I'll give you a little context as to why I asked you this question while we're talking about the community. Now, I see a relationship of this with a community building journey. Now, since we both are talking about communities, I will bring in the context. Now, you mentioned something very important right in the beginning. You said if you start chasing a buzzword, by the time you catch up with it, it will change. Okay, and then you also spoke about trying to solve a particular problem, and I see both of these things in relationship with communities as well. Okay, we are trying to solve problems for people by coming together as a community, and we are trying to make sure that the community understands that while there are buzzwords, there is a lot more to it than just the buzzwords. So, you know, for example, in the market, a lot of people are talking about things like AI, things like machine learning, things like industrial IoT. You know, there is so much, okay? Big data has been there for some time. Now, when people come together in the community forums and participate in these sort of events that you've been organizing, or the small events that we try to organize, or go to any conferences or meetups, they learn from the experts. And then there is a realization that, okay, there can be a lot more to just what we hear. You know, it's much more than just hearsay. It's about some practitioner coming and talking about a certain subject. And I want to draw people's attention to again, take them back to TribalConf. I mean, if you see the range of talks that happened there, or if you probably see what is going to be happening in Testflix, which is your upcoming event, people will get a lot of variety of information coming in. So instead of getting fixated on certain buzzwords, it is important for you to keep discovering as a process. And that is the very context why I wanted to bring in the automation thing that you spoke about with regards to shell scripting, and show people that, yeah, there is a lot more to automation than just the tools. Okay, you need to identify the problem that you're trying to solve. And similarly, in your career journey, when you have problems, when you want to talk, you know, there is a lot more to that to it than just the office work. There are communities which will help you. Okay, so it is important that we participate. I mean, you spoke about the drop rate, you know, people who register for events and don't attend. That has been a pain point for almost every event that is hosted. Okay. So how do you think, or what would be your tips in terms of being inspired to attend such events that are happening? Even if it is a small thing, like, for example, if you do an AMA with say, for example, you named Kunal. Okay. So if you do an AMA with Kunal, okay, so what would be your tips to people to attend that AMA and feel motivated about doing so?
I think I'm not qualified enough yet to answer that question, because I'm figuring out the answer. Because it goes very deep to...
What would be your motivation to attend that?
It goes very deep to people's psychology, and that's why I recently did a poll in the Test Tribe as well. What really happens, which makes you not attend a free event which you intentionally registered? And then few answers were valid, that you end up registering and then over the course of time you forget about it, or there are, you know, conflicting events and so on. While that is there, I think one of the reasons which people also said very honestly is only registering to an event, okay, that kind of gives you that psychological kick that okay, you have committed to something, you are committed to your learning. And I don't know what happens on the event day, but at least while registering it, probably people, you know, feel that pump. And then later on, what happens to that pump, I don't really know. But that's where, you know, I think we need to go back and fix a lot of problems. Like how that will happen, we all have to figure out. But it's like, why? Again, if you go back and you know, talk about buzzwords, why that happens, why people chase buzzwords and why they are so scared of it. I think one of the very strong reason is they have a fear of, you know, losing their current job if they don't chase buzzwords, or they have a fear of not getting their next job. Okay, and why that fear is, why will you fear that you will lose your current job if you are adding tremendous value to that?
Exactly.
So there you are, if you are limited to, you know, the routine thing, someone is scheduling a requirement gathering meeting, discussion meeting, and you are going there, you are listening, then you are designing test cases, then you are executing that, and then you are logging bugs, and then you are doing probably few fights with the developer, and then you are done. Now if you keep on doing this, the same stuff, and when the people who are selling these buzzwords, they are making so much noise, obviously you will be scared. So why not rather ask yourself where else you can add a value? You can, like in a small discussion like requirement gathering, testers can add so much value. I would want to tell people, if any tester is going to requirement gathering session, before reading the requirement and before taking out the questions and notes, I think you need to change that. It doesn't happen that way. Like you are just going there as, because then where the skills are coming in picture? Read, you know, invest on notebooks. They are very cheap, and most of the companies give it for free, as long as you want to use it. Invest on there. You take notes. You take your questions. I remember the grooming sessions, or we used to call it grooming or hole punching back then, and 4 to 5 pages of questions. I used to go with those many questions to a grooming, and many times the meeting will get cancelled. That because the answers are not there right away. Many times the session used to go for 3 hours and 4 hours. Those used to continue for multiple days across a week. Because initially product building is not that a client tells and then you do something. It's like we have to think, you know, how the product has to build. And that's why then that phase is done. Then are you directly going, you know, because there are BAs involved, there are developers involved, testers involved. Are you directly, you know, going back to your test case writing, or you are meeting with your developers once to do a brainstorming and asking them how you are going to build this, what other feature you are touching, which database table you are going to, you know, alter, are you going to add additional column, whether that is, you know, whether that column can accept null values or not. If it is, you know, set to not null, what values you are inserting in that. And so many other questions. Are you developing a new API? Is it dependent on other API? Ask more questions, and that's something which is a very basic thing. Be aware and ask questions. That is a phase which is there. Then ask them to show wireframe, how my screen is going to look. Raise questions on that screen. No, the button color was slightly different on the other screen. Why are we changing here? Why the placement is towards left and not towards right? So those are the things. Then adding values in deployment. When there is a defect, at least 80% or 70% of debugging testers can do themselves. Why are we simply taking a screenshot, logging a bug, and asking a developer to work into that? Right? You have a log. Okay, null pointer exception. You can very well see in the log which field is probably null and why that field's value was set to null. Right? Do some basic debugging, and that's when people will start respecting. They'll think you know it. Ask people a question. How many testers know technical stack of their product?
Correct. Yes.
If they know it, tell them. If you are talking about a web application, when you hit a URL into a browser, what happens after that? They will say the page gets loaded. Oh, that's the end result. What happens after that? What are the steps which go in between? Do we know these things? Once we know these things, we will be able to test better. We'll be able to think better. We'll be able to communicate better. And everyone will respect us, and we are not doing these things. that's why the fear is there that I may lose my job, whether I will get the next job, whether I'll get enough increment. And maybe I was overconfident, but I never had this fear for that, you know, I lose, because I knew that I'm adding enough value.
Right.
And that's when you don't have that fear. That's when you don't get into the panic mode and, you know, do things which you shouldn't do for your own good future. So I think the answer to that question goes very deep to, you know, how testers are thinking. Right. And also that victim, let me use the word, that victim mentality we have, we need to get rid of that. I know there is a background to that. A lot of us got into testing while we wanted to become a developer. And that pain is still there, that, okay, you're not good for something. People need to get away, you know, away from that, okay, it's fine. That's the history. You got into testing. Are you loving your job or not? There is a good new trend which is going around, right? Passion economy. A lot of people, like, it's a deep thing, but like it revolves around a lot around passion. I'll be very happy, glad to see, and I won't be surprised if I see a lot of testers leaving testing and picking their passion. I'll explain why I'm saying that. Because a lot of testers who are testers today, they got into testing out of helplessness, or because that was a good opportunity to get into IT, or because they couldn't crack development, right? So back then you had needs and you got into it very well and you did fantastic job. You know, you should be proud of yourself on that. Now that you have spent few years, now you might have discovered what your real passion is, because it might not be testing, or you might have, you know, started loving testing. Good, stay there. But if you discovered it is not, I'll be very happy to see people going and chasing their passion now. That will be good for them, and that will be good for testing community as a whole, because then we will have set of people who really belong here.
Absolutely, absolutely. And then there are people like me who got into testing and then discovered that testing could be a thing that could be of. That could be their passion, you know. So that is also. Are you able to hear me now?
Now I'm able to hear you. Video is a bit distorted.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah. It's the video is a bit blurred, but yeah, it's good now. Go ahead.
Okay. So your video had frozen completely. So what I'm saying is that. You know, there is another side to the story where, you know, there could be somebody like me who got into testing and discovered that testing was the passion that he was looking for. Okay, so there could be that case as well. So if you feel really, really, really close to testing, and if you think testing is something that could be your passion, well, go for it.
Exactly. That's how even I got into it. Apart from the subject STQA, Software Testing Quality Assurance, in third year, I knew nothing about testing. I just knew that I have to be curious and, you know, find what's going wrong. That's it. That's how I got into it. But yeah, once you get into it, though it be you're from a mechanical background or chemical background, or you're from a non-IT background, it is absolutely fine if you're loving it.
Yeah, and since I was talking about communities, the background, what these communities allow you is to help you discover that passion that you have. Because when you go and meet other people, when you hear their journeys, you tend to reflect upon your own journey. You tend to reflect upon your own career. You tend to introspect, okay, what am I good at? Or what is it that I like doing which makes me happy? You know, so it is important that you be a part of such communities. I have been blessed to be a part of, you know, ATA, the Test Tribe, now, you know, the Test Chat group. I am ably supported by my friends, Chintapes and Adibaro. We have some other inspiring members, you know, Hemani Yadav, one clear name that I want to take. She has been incredible with the way she has been leading the Women in Testing initiative, you know, because when we initially thought about it, we have heard stories about women in tech and women in computer science and things like that. So we just thought, okay, how about having women in testing? And the first name that popped in my head was that of Imani. And we just had a talk and she's like, yeah, I'll do it. And she's doing a fantastic job at it. I mean, it's that's how you discover that, you know, there are good people who are in your community who are doing such an incredible job, who are passionate about it. Now, again, from this women in testing journey, we are discovering that a lot of these women who have never spoken about things, okay, who have never raised a voice against anything, they come in front of the camera, do 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever they're comfortable with. They record a message, and then when they watch themselves on YouTube, okay, which has been watched by a lot of other people, they feel happy about it. And, you know, it gives us a sense of satisfaction and happiness that, you know, people are happy doing what they're doing. And this is exactly what we wanted. So behind the test chat, the story is, or the theme is, find your voice and help others find their voice. Okay, it's a simple message. So as testers, if we have found our voice, if we feel comfortable saying things the way they are, okay, we should help other testers doing the same thing. And that's what we are trying to do through the Tester Speak sessions, where, you know, you've shared your point of view, you've shared your point of view on automation, on community building. A few people will watch this, they will get ideas, maybe we'll see the rise of new communities, or we will see an increased participation into the existing community, and people will do an introspection and see, okay, this is what I should be doing, this is what I'm passionate about, you know, or find new ways of learning automation, like you said. I mean, you know, the biggest thing, the message is, you know, don't chase buzzwords, because by the time you get there, they will change. So that message was really nice. So there is a lot that can happen out of this. I mean, this has been incredible. Now I want to go back to something important that you spoke about, and said I will come back to it. So you mentioned something about having a little bit of a rough weather with biryani early days in Hyderabad. So did you discover the right taste of Hyderabadi biryani later on?
No. So when I was there in 2010, and first time I went for it, I wasn't really sure if it was chicken.
Okay.
So I stopped at I stopped at you know, probably one or two spoons, and then I never probably went for that when I was there for 2-3 months. When I went again for Signathon last October, Signathon hackathon which you did with Signity, but by that time I had turned vegetarian or eggitarian, to make it more specific. So Ajay was there, Ajay, I, and Balaji. So we went to, what is the name, Hyderabadi Darbar Biryani, something famous is there. But yeah, I and Balaji ended up eating veg biryani, which I don't know if qualifies for a biryani, but yeah, we went for that.
Okay, because I am a big foodie, and you know, biryani is one of the things that I enjoy. So I was trying to looking to learn from your experience of what Hyderabadi biryani is, because I haven't visited Hyderabad. And I want to go there especially for the biryani flavors that we hear about. So I've been watching a lot of YouTube videos and trying to get some tips from people who are into the food reviews and things like that. So I make my little notes that, okay, if you go to this city, probably this is the place where you should go and eat something else. So I want to do that. I don't want to do a probably, I do not know if I will be a food critic, food owner or not. But I'm good at eating, is what I can tell you. So and so far I do not have any plans of turning into a vegetarian or something like that. I am good the way I am. I think people like me create or help maintain a balance in the ecosystem. Otherwise, if everybody becomes a vegetarian, then there will be an imbalance, is what I feel.
Like, obviously you are also a friend, but I have another friend who often says the same thing, that he's helping universe, you know, maintain the balance.
Yes, that's what I always feel. You know, I have this funny story where in the US I was going to, with a couple of my friends, I was going to visit a zoo, and some of my American friends, they said, well, the zoo is going to be closed today because they know that a bigger carnivore is visiting them. So so that is the impression that people started getting about me. But anyways, you know, I like all kinds of food, vegetarian. Just yesterday I had Rajma Chawal, which is again one of the famous delicacies from northern India. So that's how I am, and that's some of my food habits. Now, apart from all of this, so, you know, that you do your awesome cool stuff at Cycles, that you do the great stuff that you're doing with the Test Tribe, what else does Mahesh like doing?
I like, but I haven't done a lot to that degree. I'll say I love traveling, so I think a trip to Ladakh was a highlight. Then like Kerala was good. So I haven't visited anything outside India, but I think there is so much in India itself which is in backlog. Like, I so wanted to visit Hampi, and this year, and we know what happened. Then through Test Away, Goa has been a routine place. So I don't drink. I have been there 3-4 times, and my friends keep on asking why you go to Goa. Like, so Goa has been a frequent place, but yeah. So Shimla, being at a beach, or being in the mountains, that's something I think I very deeply relate there. So that's something I like. Reading Indian mythology, during 12th, 11th, 9th, reading Mrityunjay, which is about Karna, reading books around Mahabharata. I did a lot of that. Then during engineering, it kind of went away. When I resumed the career, then again, I read a lot of Mahabharata books, fiction, non-fiction, everything. In the days in between, it had again stopped. And while we talk about all the bad things about 2020, it did quite a few good things as well, at least to me. So because I could save time and all, I could, I could reconnect to my reading habits. Otherwise, I think last year and 2018, I know people talk about, there is some name to that syndrome, that you just buy books but you don't read it. So I was in that mode. But yeah, thanks to 2020, I rediscovered that, though I pretty much restrict myself to self-help or biographies these days, or some anything which is educational enough for in my context. But yeah, that's something which I like to do.
Awesome. So one of the places that I will recommend you to visit is the northeastern part of India.
Yeah.
Especially because I come from northeast. So that's something that I want to say.
It's wonderful. Well, it's wonderful, actually. One of my friend had long back visited Arunachal Pradesh and all, and I was blown away by the pics, by the sheer beauty. That's in the
list. I'll tell you this. I mean, so my roots are from Assam. My parents are from there. I'm a Bengali, but they're from Assam. My maternal place is a city called Karimganj in southern Assam, and my paternal place, my dad's place, is the city called Digboi, which is India's oldest oil refinery is in Digboi. It's still operational. and it was established by the British long ago. So these are the two places which connect me to Assam. Not just Assam, the entire Northeast is very, very beautiful. It's just mesmerizing. I remember, as a kid, we used to go by train from Bangalore to our native homes. And it used to take 4 days by train. And those 4 days, it was incredible. Once the train enters, Assam, it crosses the Chicken's Neck, as they call the Siliguri, Jalpaiguri, that portion, and it enters the state of Assam. Everything turns green around you. Okay, there is so much of greenery, you are just mesmerized. And there is a rail route between two stations, Lamding, and there is a station called Badarpur in Assam. There are 37 tunnels in that route. So it is through the hills, and you can see the same station from three different angles. Once the train is at the station, once it is on top, and once it is below. So from three different angles, you can see the same station. It's so nice. Scenic. So I'm trying to create some interest in you and in the audience. So I get no commissions from India Tourism for doing this, or from the state of Assam for doing this. But then, it's beautiful. I wanted to share this experience too. This so it's been a long time since I have visited. Hopefully soon we go there, and let my son experience what I experienced. There are structural improvements. We have better trains. We had those meter gauge trains those days, and the climb through the hill was really slow. I could actually see people walking along the train. Seen the joy, and then getting into the train again. So all of that fun is there. But that's how life is. Well, Mahesh, thank you so much for speaking to me today. I never realized that we spoke for such a long time. It's such a wonderful conversation, and it happens every time I speak to you. We lose track of time. And thank you so much for sharing your experience. As a tester, your journey with automation, some cool tips there, your experience with community building. I mean, thank you so much for all the tips. It is always a pleasure talking to you. I'm pretty sure that you're going to talk a lot more in the days to come. And I've been seriously telling in every episode that we will do a chapter two of these talks soon. So we'll reconnect with all the speakers and do a wider range of talks. So I look forward to doing that with you. Thank you so much for your time today, Mahesh.
Thank you, Brijesh. And as you know, I rarely spoke publicly. I'm a very private public person, so it's completely opposite of what Gary Vee says. So Gary Vee says he's the most public private person. What he means by that, he's always in public, but he keeps two things very separately: what he speaks and the personal touch. I feel comfortable, sharing a lot of things. Now I can say with the tribe, right? So tribe is not necessarily the test tribe, but people where I can relate, I connect well. So I feel comfortable sharing, journey there. And thank you for allowing me and taking me back the memory lane and, allowing me to share the glimpse of that journey. And these things, right, like though it be community building, and that's what I like, the recent thing which I started with Tribal Connect, and we met there. I'm not sure if I should say that, because it was supposed to be like, whom I am meeting, I shouldn't talk about that. That is around same line. Like I, even though I'm an introvert, I love talking to people candidly, and that's what was today. And that's why I think that was one of the reason of, putting so much efforts and energy into the test drive. Because when people, message you at 12 o'clock in the night, like 1 a.m., 11 p.m., and they share their problems or their journey. I think that has been that one hook which kept me glued. Like 6-8 months into the test drive, I realized, we are up to something big and something where we are responsible now. People have started looking at with expectations, and we have to fulfill those. And so those candid conversations have been the inspiration, wherever we can help, wherever we can share the vibes. So thank you for sharing probably a lot more than what we planned, a part of your life, and we discussing the journey of us two. And yeah, so it was a great experience, and I really look forward to, connect online and offline with you as always.
Well, thank you, Mahesh, for giving me that confidence. I love talking to you every time. I spoke to you as a part of Travel Connect, if it's okay to admit that, since we are talking. And that was a good experience for me. I think other people, other testers will also benefit from that. So people should definitely use that opportunity to connect with you, because there is so much to learn from you. It's just endless. It cannot be summarized. No, I should be doing this. It cannot be summarized in this short 1.5 hour long conversation. There is a lot more to Mahesh. You guys have got to look at this guy, talk to this guy, be a part of the test drive, be a part of the test chat. Mahesh is a part of the test chat. I am a part of test drive. It goes beyond the boundaries of the communities that we are working with, the people that we are working with. We are all one family. We are all testers, is what I believe. And I think, this only helps us growing, because yeah. we've been very happy to participate in, the test drive events as TTC. We just say, okay, we are a group and we are participating in your events. People get sponsored into those events, or people come and say, hey, this is this test drive event happening. Do you think I should go there? And then we give a little bit of push, a little bit of idea, say, yes, you should attend. You already have asked that question, which means you're thinking about it. You just need a little more of it. So go there, enjoy the experience, share it with the rest of the community. And this is what has been going on. And so all good signs. 2020, it has not been really kind to the world, but I think we've found our good things. We have discovered good things with 2020.
Yeah.
So on that note, thank you so much once again, Mahesh, for this wonderful session. I think this was remarkably one of the most interesting, Tester Speak special feature sessions that I have had. Thank you so much, Mahesh, for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for hosting, and thank you for being so kind as always.
All right.
Well, don't go anywhere yet, as Mahesh has something to add. So before we say goodbye, let's listen into what Mahesh has to say. Over to Mahesh.
Okay, so hold on, guys, before you go away and resume your day. I want to give three very important shout outs here. First is join the communities. So you can join the test chat community. It's on Telegram. You can join the test drive community. It's primarily on Facebook. Bridges can possibly put the links in the description box. The second shout out, we at the test drive, we are doing events at all the metro cities currently. I mean, before the COVID kicked in. So Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, Delhi, Noida. And we even started with tier 2 cities, right? So we did our first Indore meetup, and we wanted to start with Bhubaneswar and more cities. But yeah, you know what happened. So while we'll soon resume it when things are back to the normal, I would request you all, if any tester listing us from these cities, please join us so that we can do more wonderful things in your city. That's the second thing. And as I talked about, the cities we are doing events at, so the third most important shout out goes to our city heroes who make the event, in all the cities happen. So thanks to all our city heroes, Ajay, who has been integral part of the community, Sandeep, who has been the integral part of the community, Arokya, who run the Bangalore show, these three, Then thanks to Ashwin, Anuradha, Deepan, Sumit, Dhanlakshmi. Then from Noida, Saurabh, Mansi, right? And from Hyderabad, Balaji, Sudhamshu, Anki Reddy. So thanks to you all people, Lucky from Indore. I might be forgetting few names, but yeah, so the entire interview cannot end without, you know, giving a shout out to our city heroes. So thanks for that. And thanks again, Brijesh, for having me. And thanks to the test chat.